Hello and welcome to Storytime at 9. For those of you who are joining for the first time, our storytelling sessions, please write down in the comments box so that I can know that you are a new visitor. But for those of you who have been our regular visitors and those of you who are visiting us for the first time also, just to let you know, we have been having these storytelling sessions every Saturday at 9 p.m. But today is special. Today is special because today is also different. You know, the previous Saturdays, we have been traveling to different countries with the finest storytellers from their country who used to tell us stories from their country and, of course, introduce us to the culture of their country. Those of you who've missed the earlier sessions, you can go to the YouTube channel of Bakul Foundation, okay? And what you do there, you can go to a section called playlists, okay? And in playlist, so on this YouTube channel, go to playlists and you'll find Storytime at 9. You'll find all the earlier videos. So far, we have already traveled to 37 countries. Okay, we will start story, you know, the season 3 very soon and you'll get to know that. But to get to know that, what you need to do is you need to share, subscribe or like, you know, subscribe to the YouTube channel so that you get the regular updates or like the Facebook page if that's where you're seeing it. If you're seeing it on Facebook, then again, if you go to the Facebook page of Bakul, go to the video section and you'll find the earlier storytelling videos. YouTube would be easier to navigate as a library. Okay, so that is about the earlier sessions. So next Saturday, we will not be having a storytelling session. We are taking a break. But nothing is stopping you from enjoying the storytelling sessions because whether it is today's storytelling session or the earlier ones, you can find them on our YouTube channel. In Storytime at 9. If you want to check out the Odia storytelling, check out the playlist of Robbie Bar Gopa Bar, right? And as I said, you can also find the videos on Facebook. Now, today is special because we are having a special storytelling session on hockey and with one of the finest children's authors and storytellers from India, Mr. Ramendra Kumar, with whom we've had a very long association. Now, those who don't know about Bakul, I am now sitting at the Bakul Library in Satyanagar, Bhubaneswar. And this is not a wallpaper, these are actual books. Okay, this is an actual library and you saw images of the library in the intro video. Now, Mr. Ramendra Kumar was in Rourkela earlier and welcome, sir. And he's written more than 35 books, you know, very prolific author, won many awards. And also, not only that, you know, there are, of course, other children's authors, not as many, you know, not too many who are as good, as wonderful as him. But not only is he a wonderful storyteller also, but he has written many books on sports and particularly on hockey. You know, I'm sure many of you are very proud. I know that most of us are from Odisha and we are very proud that Odisha has taken up sports in a big way, that we are promoting particularly hockey and now even beyond hockey, you know, other sports. The Odisha government is sponsoring the Indian hockey teams, both the men's and women's. And now they have a long-term commitment to promoting hockey. A lot of other things happening. So before we go to Mr. Ramendra Kumar's wonderful stories today, and he'll be telling us stories about Dhyan Chand, about whose biography he has written, about Dilip Tirki, you know, national icon as well as state icon, as well as a wonderful fun story. That he has written a fictional story. Let us just hear Mr. Vinil Krishna, who happens to be the commissioner come secretary, the Sports and Youth Services Department of the Government of Odisha. What does he have to say about this session? And then we'll move on to Ramendra, sir.
I'm happy to know that Bakul Foundation is organizing a storytelling session on hockey. After the Tokyo Olympics, there is great interest again in hockey. Thanks to the spectacular performance of our Indian teams, hockey has been revived. It's a matter of pride that Odisha has been able to support hockey due to the vision of our Honorable Chief Minister Shri Naveen Patnaik. We have a close partnership with Hockey India for long-term development of hockey in the state and the country. So it's the right time to recollect the glory of hockey in India. Bakul Foundation and Sri Sujit have been doing phenomenal work through their libraries, storytelling, art, etc. Sri Raminder Kumar is an expert storyteller and writes greatly on the sports person. Both have come together during the last World Cup and created a wonderful storytelling and captivating storytelling festival during the at that time. So we look forward to associating with them again and in the interest of the development of sports in the state. Wish you all the best and have a great storytelling session. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Vineet sir, for this wonderful message, and definitely Ramendra sir, and we'll be happy to collaborate. And so today, children, you are not just listening to a storytelling, you are listening to a beginning of a longer, a larger and a bigger story, which was just, you just heard today. Ramendra sir, over to you.
Yeah. Thank you to Mr. Vineet Krishna for his inspiring words. Now, guys, let me take you back to 1984. A small, dusty, remote village in one corner of Odisha. A tournament was taking place, a hockey tournament. There was a lot of excitement. People were shrieking and shouting and cheering the respective teams. It was like a picnic. Women folk had come with some lunch and some goodies to eat. Men were cheering, and there among them was a seven-year-old child sitting with his father. The game came to an end, and Ignace Ekka, the captain of the winning team, walked up to the dais, and this young boy's father jumped up in ecstasy, and he said, "Finally, we have won the trophy after 3 years. And you know what the trophy was? It was not a glittering cup, nor a shining trophy. It was a goat or a khasi. So those days, I think even today, the tournament was called the khasi tournament, and villagers would vie for the trophy, which was a goat. And this young man clutching his father's hand was so happy, so euphoric. He went back in that evening, that night as he slept, he dreamt of holding a trophy, a glittering cup, not a goat, an actual trophy in his hand, and making his village, his state, his country proud. Can you guess who this man was? He started from a village, a remote, dusty village in one corner of Sundargarh district called Sionmara, and from there, he rose to the rank of becoming India's hockey captain. He is the first tribal Padma Shri award winner. He is the first tribal to represent our country in 3 Olympics. He is the first tribal captain after Jaipal Singh Munda in 1928. He is the first hockey player, or rather, he is the hockey player with the maximum international caps. He is the second highest international player in terms of number of times he has represented his country. Yes, his name is Dilip Tirki. I'm sure you'd have guessed. I had the great opportunity of interviewing him on a number of occasions because I was writing his biography. This biography, in the form of a story, I submitted to Children's Book Trust and it got an award. I called it A Player and a Gentleman. And that sums up Dilip Tirki. As I talked to his coaches and his family members, his colleagues, his seniors, I came to know the reason why Dilip Tirki is Dilip Tirki. First and foremost, he was dedicated, hardworking, brilliant. He would never, ever take anything for granted. His coach, Mr. Kaushik, told me that after the match, all his colleagues would go to their respective rooms and have some fun. And he would be in the field practicing for the next day. In terms of defense, he has been rated as the best defender during his time. The mercurial player of Pakistan, Mr. Shahbaz, he said, "I fear Dilip Tirki the most. In fact, to get past him is very, very difficult. And if I can dribble past him, then I'm sure to score the goal." He has been called the wall and compared to Rahul Dravid, both in terms of temperament as well as the sheer perseverance and the ability to fight against all odds. I would appeal to you to please spread the word about Dilip Tirki, about this great man, this modest, unassuming, shy man who took our country to the heights of fame and was forever modest, gentle, and kind. Now, Sujit, if you want to become Dilip Tirki, you might have to shed a bit of weight. What do you say?
A bit of weight or two-thirds of my weight?
I was just being kind to
you. Diplomatic.
Exactly, diplomatic.
Well, really inspirational. And I think even behind, you know, I talked earlier before you started talking about Mr. Dilip Tirki about Odisha and Odisha's promotion of hockey. I think if it were not for Dilip Tirki, because he was the first big icon from Odisha who made it big, right? Or did we? I mean, we had hockey players, but no one who really made a name at the national level the way he did, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. And he's an inspiration not only for the hockey players, he's an inspiration for every sports person. In fact, do you know that he's a complete teetotaler? You understand? And every aspect of his, when he hung his boots, when he retired, it was not in some kind of a media circus and all that. He was playing an ordinary kind of match, and during the interval, he just called a few sports persons and said, "I don't think I'm fit enough to represent the country. Let someone else take over." How gentle and how unselfish this gesture was, you tell me.
Definitely, definitely. That's great. But we will move on to Ramendra Sir's another story. But just before that, of course, I want to wish all the teachers who are listening to the show a very happy Teachers' Day in advance. I want to ask all the children to ensure that you thank all your teachers tomorrow. And your teachers are not only the teachers who teach you in school. Your teachers are whoever you have learned from, anything from, right? And they could be anyone. Your parents, you learn so much from your parents, from your relatives, from friends. So I'm sure all of you will thank each of your friends. Now, how do you thank people that you love, that you respect on Teachers' Day? There are many ways of thanking. One of the ways, and a way that we particularly love, is by gifting plants, right? So, for example, can we have that poster here? So, you know, it's Happy Teachers' Day, right? So, three cheers for teachers. They are the ones who made us grow. So why don't we give them a gift that also grows? That's the beauty of a plant. It's the only gift that grows. You may give other things, which is fine, but this is the only gift that grows. So think about, you can always gift a plant to your teachers. I know many of you do that, and thank you for that. Let's go over to Ramendra Sir for the next story.
What a lovely thought, Sujit, regarding plants and saplings. I still have the saplings which you gifted me over the years, and they are so close to my heart. So this story is called A Perfect Match. It's been published by Pratham Books, and it's gone into quite a few reprints and has been translated into many languages. So it has been illustrated by Nilufar Wadia. So this story is about a Dadaji and a Dadiji. Now, both were very fond of hockey. Dadaji had retired as a branch manager in a senior position. He was a tall, well-built man with a thick mustache. And Dadiji was slim and short, but with a fiery temper. And she had retired as a school principal, and she treated everybody like an errant student. Both of them lived with their grandchildren, Sakshi and Saket. Now, they were very fond of hockey. The Dadaji and Dadiji, Sakshi and Saket. So the Dadiji used to kind of mentor a team of boys called Halwas. And Dadaji used to mentor a team of girls who were named Jalebis. The names were given by Dadaji. He was a diabetic and he always thought about sweets. So he thought of giving some names after some very tasty delicacies like halwas and jalebis, all mouth-watering stuff. Now, the team of halwas and jalebis, they played in a ground which was divided into half. One half the jalebis played, one half the halwas played. So when the story begins, the Dadaji and Dadiji are having an argument. Dadiji says, "My halwas are the best." Dadaji says, "That's what you think. They can't beat my jalebis." Dadiji says, "That's what you think." Dadaji replies, "That's what I know. Okay, let's have a match." Dadaji says, "Okay, next Sunday, 10th, we will have a match in the field." Dadiji says, "Go and tell your jalebis that they are about to play a match which they are sure to lose." And before Dadaji can reply, Dadiji goes away. And Dadiji goes to the boys and says, "Boys, you have to be ready to play a match with the jalebis." Dadaji's jalebis. The boys, led by their captain, Narendra, say, "What did you say, Dadiji? We have to play with those girls? How can we play with the girls? Everybody will say that we are sissies for the rest of our lives. We can't play with girls." Dadiji looks at him and suddenly Rajendra comes forward and says, "Dadiji, all those girls are so snooty. All females are snooty." Dadiji takes his ear and tweaks it. "What did you say? Have you forgotten that I'm also a female?" Then Rajendra says, "No, Dadi, you're a Dadiji, no. You're a sweetheart. You're a darling. You're not snooty at all." Dadiji is very happy. But again, she puts on a grim expression and says, "Don't try to, you know, put maska on me. You have to play. Or are you scared that the jalebis will make halwa out of you?" Then all the boys got up and said, "No question of that. We will play the jalebis and we will make halwas out of the jalebis." And there, Dadaji went to the girls and put his proposal. Rehana, the captain of the team, said, "What? You want us to play with those ill-mannered louts?" Roshni, whose brother Rohan was in the other team, said, "We can't play with them. They are such big ruffians. We will not play. We can't do that." Dadaji said, "Oh, that means my dear brave jalebis are afraid of playing with the halwas." Now, this was one challenge the jalebis couldn't, you know, refuse. "Okay, Dadaji, we will take them on and we will beat them to pulp." And so the day of the match approached. A lot of practice sessions were held. Dadaji was using his strategy as a manager to tell his team of jalebis what all moves, maneuvers they should indulge in. Dadiji, who herself was a very good player, was telling them, giving them some tips on dribbling, on scooping, on taking penalty corners and penalty shots. The day arrived, and Dadaji's friends, with whom he used to take a long walk every day, joined in as spectators. Dadaji used to do a lot of dancing with her friends. They also came and joined. The parents of the others came in as spectators. The ice cream wala, the chana phali wala, they also joined. And there was a huge crowd to see this exciting, scintillating, fascinating, enthralling match between the halwas and the jalebis. The match started. Fatima of the jalebi team started moving fast, dribbling to the left, to the right, to the left, to the right. And then Narendra blocked her. And then it went on and on and on. Dadaji was so full of trepidation and apprehension and fear that his team would lose. He started twirling his mustache and even started plucking the hair. Another half an hour and he would have been completely bare here. But for the fact that Dadaji looked at him askance and with anger, he said, "What are you doing?" And here Dadaji was jumping up and down with excitement and using language which Dadaji had never ever heard her use. Just then, Manju passed to Sanju. Sanju passed to Geeta. Geeta passed to Sita, and Sita shot the goal. And goal! Everybody shouted. Dadaji was so excited that he gave a kichi, puppy kiss to Dadaji. And Dadaji completely forgot that what a calamity has fallen on her team and blushed. After around 5 or 10 minutes, this time Narendra gave to Rajendra, Rajendra gave to Dharmendra, Dharmendra gave to Suraj, Suraj gave to Kiran, Kiran gave to Sherpa, and goal! The match was now 1-1 and had entered the extra time. And just 2 minutes were left. People were going, the spectators were going crazy, cheering, loudly shouting, screeching and screaming. Then suddenly, a shape ran forward, a black shape on four legs. It was Tufan, the black doggy of Sakshi and Saket. He had been trying to get the ball for the last 1 week, but his two siblings, Sakshi and Saket, they're not allowing him. They were shooing him away. But now he got the chance. He grabbed the ball and he ran. He was the fastest thing on four legs. He ran across the field where Dada used to walk. He ran across the Maidan where Dada used to dance and went straight to where his girlfriend Andhi was waiting for him. And here, everybody started looking for the ball. Behind the bushes, under the benches, behind the trees, between the legs, here, there, everywhere, they looked and looked and looked. The rivals, jalebis and halwas, forgot their enmity or rivalry and looked together, but they could not find the ball. They tried to call back Tufan, but Tufan had disappeared. Now, what was to be done? They asked Dadaji and Dadiji. Dadaji, Dadiji, what is the result of the match now? Dadaji said, "It's a tie. And both the teams have played so well, the halwas and the jalebis, that I'm going to give each of you a t-shirt." Everybody jumped with joy and clapped their hands. And Dadaji said, "I'm going to cook some lovely jalebis and some delicious halwas, and tomorrow we'll have a picnic here." Everybody again jumped up. Then Fatima asked Dadaji and Dadaji, "If the match was a tie, who is the man of the match?" Dadaji smiled and said, "There is no man of the match. It is champion of the match. And that is Tufan for giving a perfect end to a perfect match." Thank you. So, Sujit, you are fond of halwas or jalebis or both?
Actually, both. You know, I'll tell you the secret behind this. Size matters. So what happens is, I often have a fight, but it is not between jalebi and halwa. It is between meetha and khara. So I have something meetha, like a chhena puro, and I would like to have a generous helping, and then I feel, zyada meetha ho gaya, thoda mixture chahiye. Then thoda mixture kha leta hu, because mixture should not feel bad. And then thoda zyada mixture ho gaya, to usko balance karne ke liye aur thoda meetha ho jata hai. So that is how I balance my the war between Meetha and Khara. So, but that was a lovely story. You know, I have heard it earlier. You had told at the storytelling festival, Bhufesto, which Mr. Vinil Krishna mentioned. How many of you, by the way, children had been to that storytelling festival 3 years back during the Hockey World Cup?
In my session, this particular.
No, you had told this story also, no? Perfect match?
Yeah. I told, and that day there were more than 200, 250 students. The children.
So I was just asking the children. Children, how many of you had been to the storytelling festival, Bhufesto, during the Hockey World Cup? Please write down in the comments if you did. And if any of you attended Ramendra Sir's session, particularly during the Hockey World Cup, it was at the Indira Gandhi Park. Of course, he told stories both at all the parks, you know, at Indira Gandhi Park, at Buddha Jayanti Park, at Kharavela Park. Okay, Sana Shining Star. Okay, Sanvi Bhuvalka, you had done wonderful. Okay, so I think, sir, two of your fans from 3 years back are listening to you again.
Great.
Okay, wonderful. Wonderful, Sana. Sana, where do you study? Which class now? And also about you, Bhuvalka, Sanvi, which school and which class? By the way, I had announced last time that, you know, we have reopened one of our libraries. The library where I'm sitting, that has not reopened yet. We will soon. But the library inside Biju Patnaik Park, popularly called Forest Park, in Bhubaneswar, that has reopened. So you can go down, not anytime, but between 7 to 10 a.m. in the morning or 4 to 7 p.m. in the evening. Okay. And before Ramendra Sir tells us the big punch storytelling for today, the story of Dhyan Chand, let us just see this little video about the Forest Park Library. So this is kind of showing you the way how to go to the library inside the park. Forest Park Library. We'll move over to Ramendra Sir's story, the last story for today. And after that, remember, children, there will be the question and answer session. So those of you who want to ask questions, you can ask in the comments box wherever you are seeing it, on Facebook, YouTube, or Twitter. But one last thing, if you are loving these stories, you know what you're supposed to do, right? What are you supposed to do? You're supposed to share the video. You're not supposed to keep it to yourself. Share the video with all your friends and your friends' friends and their friends. Okay, share the video definitely. And to know about all these sessions, definitely subscribe to the YouTube channel or like the Facebook page. I see that many of you have joined in the middle of the session. If you have missed out on the first story that Sir has said, then you can always go back. This video remains on YouTube and Facebook. Okay, you can go back and see this video. You can go back and see the other earlier storytelling videos also. As I said, you can see it on the playlist of Storytime at 9, the Odia. Ramendra Sir last year also told stories twice in Rabibar Gappobar, you know, in Odia. So you can listen to how his Odia sounds in Rabibar Gappobar in those episodes that you can find. But now, the story that we've all been waiting for, the story of Major Dhyan Chand.
Thank you. Now, just imagine, I'm taking you back in history. 1936 Berlin Olympics, the Indian hockey team was pitted against the German team. It was the final. And in the pavilion was the most powerful man of that era, Adolf Hitler. The chancellor was sitting there to witness the annihilation of the Indian team by the mighty German team. He was waiting that once again Germany would prove its Aryan supremacy over Indian Indian team, which in 1936 India was a part of the British Empire. We were not independent, right? We were a slave nation, and Hitler wanted to see how his great team would smash us. 70 minutes later, Hitler's fantabulous dream was shattered. It was blown to smithereens. It was beaten to pulp. The Indian team led by Dhyan Chand beat the German team 8-1 in the finals. And the architect of the victory was the wizard of hockey, Dhyan Chand. When Hitler saw the wizard play, he wanted to meet him. He called him over to his cabin and asked him, "What is your rank in the Indian Army? I came to know that you're in the Indian Army." So he said, "My rank is Lance Nayak. I will make you a major general. I can even make you a field marshal. Come and play for the German army." You know what Dhyan Chand replied? He said, "I would rather be a Lance Nayak in the Indian army than a field marshal in the German army." Just imagine the sense of patriotism which Dhyan Chand epitomizes. Let me take you back to that match. In the first half, India could score only one goal. In the second half, in the opening minutes itself, India had knocked off 7 more goals and were leading 8-1. The Germans started getting aggressive. And one of the players swung his stick purposely, and Dhyan Chand's teeth were broken. He was let out. He came back 10-15 minutes later. Now, normally people would say that once a person is hurt so badly, he'll come back and try to seek revenge, vengeance. But Dhyan Chand was a completely different player, completely different personality. He told his players, "We will not resort to aggression. Rather, we will teach the German team a lesson in artistry, in wizardry." So what did the Indian team do? They would take the ball and dribble right up to the D, very near the goalpost, dribble around for quite some time, tease the Germans and come back. They wouldn't score a goal. But it was clear to all the spectators who were watching that the Indians were playing with the mighty German team. And they were teaching them a lesson, not only in artistry, but also in sportsman spirit. Back home, another legendary figure was fighting the might of the British Empire, Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. He was also using his strengths of resilience, of willpower, of non-violence, of peace. And he also ultimately won. So I wrote a biography, which was again awarded by the Children's Book Trust. And I called the biography "The Mahatma of the Hockey Field." I compared Dhyan Chand to the Mahatma. And over the years, the legend of Dhyan Chand has been growing. In Vienna, they erected a statue of his with 4 legs and 4 arms, because they said that no man with 2 hands and 2 feet can play hockey like this. In Japan, they checked whether there was a magnet in his hockey stick. In Germany, they announced in Berlin that the magician is here. So if you want to witness a magic show, please come to the stadium. In some other country, they checked whether he had applied some kind of a glue to his stick with which he could stick to the, I mean, the stick could attach itself to the ball and he could score goals and goals and goals. In Australia, Donald Bradman, when he met Dhyan Chand, said, "Oh my God, you score goals like I score runs." That is the legend of Dhyan Chand. Dhyan Chand has recently been, I mean, the Rajiv Gandhi Khel Ratna Award has been renamed the Dhyan Chand Khel Ratna Award. Am I happy? No, I'm only satisfied. I have created a campaign that Dhyan Chand should be awarded the Bharat Ratna. He is the greatest sportsman India has ever produced. That's why his birthday, 29th August, is celebrated as the National Sports Day. He's the greatest hockey player the world has ever seen. His passion for the game, his diligence, his dedication is unparalleled, unrivaled. You know, once he was asked by a German coach, a German team, that would he like to coach the German team? He would be getting a lot of money. And Dhyan Chand, his condition was not all that good financially, but still he refused. So somebody asked him, "Why did you refuse? You were going to get so much of money." He said, "Suppose I coach the German team and if it beats the Indian team, how can I see my face in the mirror?" That was the level of patriotism, that level of commitment. Now, in today's times, many sports persons would coach any team anywhere in the world for money. But for Dhyan Chand, money didn't matter. Patriotism mattered. Nationalism mattered. And I would request all of you to please try to learn more and more about Dhyan Chand, the greatest hockey player the world has ever seen, the Merlin of hockey. So, Sujit, how much do you know about Dhyan Chand?
I'm discovering new things from your story today. But I will also, as you said, I will also definitely want to explore further. I think, sir, a pura independent book banta hai. I think we should have it from you.
No doubt about it. No doubt about it.
Let us have a picture book also. Let us have, the way we have other books, let us have a book with attractive pictures for our young readers here. Let us do that, definitely.
So that reminds me, Sujit, I had just forgotten. I interviewed his son, Ashok Kumar, who also played for India and was a part of the 1975 gold medal winning team, which won the gold at Malaysia, Kuala Lumpur. I asked him, "What is the greatest quality of Dhyan, of your father?" And you know what he said? He said, "Humility." And according to me, Dilip Tirki has the same humility. Isn't it such a great coincidence that two outstanding players possess such a sterling quality in a large measure?
Definitely. You know, children, that reminds me of a thing. They say to be great, you actually need to be humble. Because, see, for example, when it comes to learning, there are people who think they know a lot. And there are people who are aware about how little they know. If you're aware of how little you know, that, you know, eggs you on to want to know more and more. And that is how you know more. So that is something that is, you know, I know that you keep hearing a lot about a lot of gyan, you know, you do this, be humble and all. But truly what sir said, I have seen it in most great people, you know, because it requires certain humility to feel your own insignificance, to want to continually quest for something bigger, greater. I think that is the mark of greatness. Very, very good point you made, sir. So children, what questions do you have for Ramendra, sir? Do type in. But meanwhile, Latika, yes, thanks for, you know, constantly reminding that August 29th, in fact, that was one of the things on our minds, that we are having this storytelling session soon after Dhyan Chand's birthday, within a week of his birthday, which was celebrated as the National Sports Day. Sir also mentioned that. And Shell, wonderful to know that you had also attended the storytelling festival at Bufesto. But let's see, what questions do you have? What would you like to know from Ramendra sir, either about himself, his storytelling, his books, or about the players that he talked about hockey? Santosh says, great people are really humble. Yes, indeed. And Santosh, why do you say that you cannot go to the Forest Park Library? Thank you very much for saying that, you know, you love the ambience, but are you not here in Bhuvaneshwar? Yes, any questions for Ramendra, sir? I don't see any coming.
So let me add one point, which I wanted to share earlier, that I had given a proposal once that, you know, Sundargarh district is, how should I say, is possibly the greatest nursery of hockey in our country. I had talked to Michael Kindo, who's from the Chota Nagpur Plateau, where Sundargarh district also is there. So he said that the Adivasi, our Adivasi brothers and sisters, they have it in their DNA because they are very sturdy. They can bend over a hockey stick for a long time because their ancestors were farmers. They are agile and they are very dedicated. So taking a cue from this, I like the Honorable Chief Minister of Odisha, he has done a humongous job by sponsoring the teams. And for the next 10 years also, he has committed that he would sponsor the teams. The country's biggest hockey stadium is coming right next door in Rourkela. And just imagine the kind of encouragement that would give. What I would like to add is, I want the private sector companies, the television reality show specialists, to organize a like you have a reality show for Saregama, Indian Idol, for music and dance. Have one for hockey. Go to the villages. Villages in Sundargarh and other places. Punjab.
Who's the next player?
Identify players. Pick them up and then have matches between them. Like halwas and jalebis. Have serious matches between them. Pick up a team of 15 people. You know, 15 players or 20 players or 30 players. From the age of 8 to 12. And then groom them. Call them Hockey Ke Sartaj. Call the program Hockey Ke Sartaj. And if you groom them with the right kind of, you know, spirit and motivation, possibly in the next 10 or 15 years, we'll get a gold in every Olympic, in every World Cup, in every Asia.
Wonderful idea. I think we can suggest it when we talk to the sports secretary about, you know, maybe having more biographies and all. We can also suggest this idea to him. I think that would be wonderful. Meanwhile, we have a question from Santosh. I see another interesting question that he has. In fact, a suggestion. But first, what is the next biography you are working on?
Actually, I've just completed a kind of an autobiography, a fictionalized account of my 32 years in SAIL Rourkela Steel Plant. It's a fictionalized account, but the core is hard facts. So I think it's going to make a splash because I have, you know, gone full on with a lot of punch and a lot of satire and a lot of humor. So I think, I hope people would enjoy that. It's not a children's book. It's for adults.
It's a book on your memoirs of your time.
Exactly.
Okay.
So any plans for writing a thriller?
Yeah, it's more like a suggestion. I think it's a wonderful suggestion.
Yeah, see, actually what I'm doing now is I had written a novel called Now or Never in 2010. I'm kind of rewriting it in the present context. It's basically a father and son relationship story with a backdrop of boxing. So I'm now working on completely expanding the horizons, getting the other characters in, making it in the here and now.
So Shail is asking about your first story.
That's very interesting. My first story was written for my daughter. It's called Just a Second, and it talks about the importance of second. People say just a second, but if the second stops, everything else stops. So it's a parable where second is insulted and second stops working, and everything in the world comes to a grinding halt, then the people of the world go to Father Time and he requests second to come back into action.
But why don't you also share the story of how you started storytelling? You know, about okay. your children and your yeah. wife. I mean, I've heard that story, but
thank
I think
you. That's a very interesting question. So my daughter was 4 when my son happened. My wife also works in the steel plant. So she had her hands full. So she encouraged me. She said, you're such a useless fellow. You can't run a washing machine. You can't boil an egg. You can't sing lullaby. You can't wash bums. You're utterly useless in everything. You think you're a great writer. No. Tell Ankita, our daughter, stories while I take care of Aniket. So I started telling stories to my daughter. I do not know whether she loved the antics, the jumping around or the content, but she lapped them all up. And when my son grew up, I had to tell stories to both of them. And their tastes were exactly the opposite. My daughter liked, once upon a time, long, long ago, there lived a beautiful princess. She fell in love with a tall, dark, handsome prince. Suddenly, a Rakshasa strode in. And the prince, using his creativity, his ingenuity and skill, locked the Rakshasa in the dungeon. And the prince and the princess lived happily ever after. My son was the opposite. He liked Superman, Batman, Iron Man, every kind of violence kind of thing, you know. And for him, it was all dishum dishum. So in the first few sentences, the hero should be pulling the villain's lips apart. And by the end of the story, the hero should have removed the villain's kidney and stuffed it in his mouth. So all violence and gore and dishum dishum. So to balance, once upon a time, long, long ago, and dishum 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 was one hell of a task. But finally, I could manage some kind of a balance. That's why 40 books today, and that's why I'm a writer and a storyteller. Otherwise, I would have stopped in the first story itself. So my kids are basically my inspiration.
Yeah. So Sohan wants to know which state. I think you can tell the journey where you are now also.
Yeah. My father is from Lucknow. I was born and brought up in Hyderabad. I worked for 32 years in Sare Jahan Se Achcha, Odisha Hamara. And now I'm in Bangalore. Namma Uru, Bangalore.
Sunil wants to know a bit about your books.
See, I write in all genres, like from picture books for 5-year-olds to young adult, 16, 17, 18, 19 and all that. But maximum number of books which I've written, if I have to pick up a theme, it is sports, because I love writing about sports. That rush of adrenaline, that camaraderie, that comradeship, that excitement, that thrill. I feel sports is a metaphor for life. So I love writing about sports. I've written scary stories also, and adventure stories and mystery stories and biographies, everything.
Latika wants to know if she wants to join hockey, you know, what could be the way?
She has to approach her sports teacher and tell him that I want to play hockey and I'm going to work really hard and I'm going to be really good. That's how you start. But hard work, dedication, determination, and never ever giving up. Two examples. Dhyan Chand, from a small place in a remote corner of Jhansi, and Dilip Tirki from again a village in Sundargarh, both of them reached the height only through dedication and, of course, skill and determination. But if you are not willing to work hard, I'm sorry, in no field of life can you succeed. I think Sujit will agree.
Definitely. So I think this is the last question we'll take today. Shell's question. Have you played hockey, sir?
I've played hockey. But I wasn't good. I was good only in table tennis. And in cricket, I was a good leg spinner. Reasonably good leg spinner. Reasonably good. But in TT, I was quite okay.
I'm visualizing you know. Turning your hands and the
box. Okay. But hockey, so I did play for my... I played
but
for my
where
class.
Where was that? In Hyderabad Public School?
Hyderabad Public School, Begumpet. HPS Begumpet. And I was very bad at it. I was not good at all.
So maybe one day you should try and score a goal with our chief minister who was the...
yeah. yeah. True. That will be really interesting.
So wonderful having you, sir. I think we had a great session. So children, once again, as I said, we are taking a break from the Saturday storytelling sessions today. After today, we won't be having a storytelling session next Saturday. But those of you who joined later today, or if you've missed the earlier storytelling sessions, go to YouTube, go to the playlist Storytime at 9, and you'll find this session and the earlier videos. So you can see, you want to see, listen to the stories once again, you can listen to them. You listen to some stories today, could not listen to all the stories, you can again go to that video. You can go to the earlier sessions also, right? So we have taken a break, but that is not stopping you from taking a break from listening to this big, rich mine of storytelling, wonderful storytelling that we have on our YouTube channel and on the Facebook page, right? So definitely check them out. And if you have subscribed to the channel, the YouTube channel, or like the Facebook page, you will get the notification when we start the resume the storytelling sessions. So till then, see you. Sir, anything you would like to say?
I would only like to tell the children and the parents that please, if you're a parent, encourage your child to play sports. And if you're a kid, please just don't watch television or, you know, restrict your sports to reading or watching TV. Go out and play in the fields, please. Because sports teaches you so many values which you can't get in any other space. So go out and play. Whether you win or lose, it doesn't really matter. But get that physical exercise. Get that adrenaline pumping. Enjoy that camaraderie, comradeship. Enjoy that excitement. Enjoy that thrill.
You know, on that line, I'll tell you something, sir. I did my master's in English at Hyderabad University, the central university there. In the hostel, we had this TT table. Okay. And just before my exams, I would get stressed out because I would always study at the last minute. And, and whenever I needed motivation or I would feel stressed out, I would go and play TT with friends, and I would come back with all adrenaline pumping and all motivated. Yes, abhi for denge. You know, that is what you said. You know, it completely resonated with me because that is what used to happen with me.
100%. Nothing. I mean, sports is such a great stress buster. Such a great stress buster.
And also, you get all fired up, you know, that whole spirit of...
That excitement happens.
Yeah, the thrill. Wonderful. So thank you so much, sir, for a wonderful session once again. But as I said at the beginning of the session, as the sports secretary, Mr. Vinil Krishna, said, this should not be... This is not going to be a one-off session. Now, this is going to be the beginning of a journey of bringing more stories to all of you through books and through sessions like this, of inspiring you with the stories of our sports persons. And we would really love to see Latika, you know, saying that, you know, like she's saying now that she's interested in hockey. We would love to see more and more young people from our state thinking of sports as a career, and parents also being proud of children taking up sports as a career. So thank you very much, everyone. Do watch the end video. And till the next time, bye-bye.
Bye.